For tape, CDs, DVDs to our publication, Voices from His Excellent Glory, Declaring the Kingdom, write P.O. Box 21516, Hot Springs, Arkansas, zip 71903. Our website is www.LakeHamiltonBibleCamp.com and LHBCOnline.com. There are many hundreds of free audio files there. It's like going to Bible school at home.
Friday afternoon, June the 26th, 1981. Lake Hamilton Bible Camp, summer family camp meeting. Frank Mendola is the teacher of the afternoon. Subject is Break Those Curses. This is tape one of two tapes.
To show you the scriptures that we're going to use today, and I've already put them on the blackboard, for those of you who can't see them, the first one is Genesis 9, starting with verse 24. Joshua 6, and it's parallel scripture, 1 Kings 16:34, 2 Kings 2:23, Judges 9, and Acts 13, beginning of verse 6. Okay? And this is the beginning of a two-part message on Break Those Curses. Now, curses, being an engineer, and thank God, given a logistical mind, I'm going to start at the very foundation. What is a curse? Okay, let's start with Webster's Dictionary. Webster's Dictionary says this: a prayer or invocation to call down harm or injury upon another. Okay, that's one. To call upon divine or supernatural power to send injury upon another. To execrate in fervent and often profane terms. That's what is the common vernacular as cursing or swearing. But that's not the context of what we're going to use curses today. That's actually using profanity. Or, as you heard when the Watergate tapes came out, expletive deleted. If you're with me. That's not what we're going to use for our definition of cursing. In fact, if you remember the story of David and Shimei, when Absalom was taking control of Jerusalem, David had to flee from his own son. And as he passed by the way of Shimei's house, Shimei came out, shook his fist, started hurling stones, and, as Webster would say, he was execrating in fervent and profane terms. Okay? It wasn't a curse per se. It was what we call using profanity. So what can we summarize, and what is the context we want to use today? It is this, and I encourage you, if you want to take notes, by all means, go ahead and do so. What is a curse? It is to pray, invoke, call upon a divine or supernatural power to send injury or harm or evil upon another person. But actually, that definition is not succinct in all its ramifications of what we find in the Word of God as to what cursing can be. Cursing truly can be, and for the subject of today, will be only that. We will only discuss that definition and that application. However, there are three more curses that go along with this invocation thing. Listen, we'll call the praying or invoking divine supernatural power to send injury upon another, we'll call that category A. B, those curses resulting from the law of sowing and reaping. That is, those resulting from a lack of following God's command. We'll get into that tomorrow. But there are curses if you don't follow God's command. Everybody wants the blessings, but nobody wants to meet the conditions. No, you got to have one with the other, because if you don't meet, you know what our thinking has been? Well, if we don't meet the conditions, we just don't inherit the blessings. Well, that's true, but it's not complete. Not only if you don't meet the conditions, you will not inherit God's blessings, you do inherit something. It's called a curse. Chew on it. Some of you, it got stuck right about here, some of you. But it's true. Again, we'll go into that. We'll discuss Deuteronomy 28 tomorrow. Category C, those produced by certain objects. Objects you can see. Objects in your home. objects that you wear on your person. Objects which include gifts like when you got married. Objects that you picked up because someone thought you ought to have. Objects you thought that would be real nice if you put them on your person or hung them up in your home, such as a picture. Such as statues, idols, books, tapes, whether it be cassette or A-track, record albums. And we'll get into that much more deeply tomorrow. Category D, and I want you, you're probably familiar with the first three, and you probably have very little problem with the first three. But fasten your seatbelts. Of course, category D is those curses that result from out-of-balanced teachings. Those curses that result from out-of-balanced teachings. And we will get into it tomorrow. I hope I'm whetting your appetite so you come back. Because I cannot discuss it all today. It's just too much. Okay. Category A, those which are pronounced. There are actually two types, even amongst that. And believe it or not, just when we speak of curse, the thing that pops into your mind is an evil curse. And that's true. There are evil curses. But there are also just curses. There are just curses. What is a just curse? Just curses are those pronounced only by children of God to cause the just judgment of God to fall upon the unrighteous and disobedient. It's those pronounced only by children of God. A devil or a demon, someone who is lost, cannot produce a just curse. Only a man of God, only a child of God. And what is his reason? To send people to hell? To say, turn or burn? No. It's to allow the just judgment of God to fall upon the unrighteous and disobedient. And don't you cover up not causing judgment to fall when it should, under the excuse that you got the agape love of Jesus. Because God's a God of love and he's a God of judgment. The problem with people today is they're so sloppy agape, they can't say black is black and white is white. They cover it up and hide themselves under the excuse that they got the love of Jesus in their hearts. There's a time for love, but there's a time for judgment. And there's one thing that's going to come upon the church is judgment. Where do you get that, Brother Frank? Go read Peter. And he'll tell you that the time has come that the judgment of God must come to the house of God first. What? Not the red light district? No. Not the porno film movies? No. The judgment got to come to the house of God. And it goes on, it says, if it first come to us, what shall the end of be? And obey not the gospel of God. And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and sinner appear? If the righteous are scarcely saved, where shall the ungodly and sinner appear? It's quiet today, but that's the word of God. That's the truth. You can assimilate it or spit it out. That's up to you. I know what I'm talking about. Okay, that's the judgment of God. And I hope what you see up here, you don't see the anger of a man, but the judgment of God. Because it's going to come. And I'm testing right now a prophecy that says that I'm going to be one to have that power. And I know that if I'm going to ever move in that area, I've got to be faithful with what God has given me. Because that is an awesome thing. As you're going to find out, be able to call upon the judgment of God. We're going to go through five scriptures. Okay, Brother Frank, I understand that part. Don't really like it, but I understand it. Thank you for being honest. What's an evil curse? Now, this is a little bit more difficult. And you're not going to like this either. But it's those pronounced by either, one, children of the devil, which we call unbelievers, or, seatbelts fastened, or misguided children of God to bring the evil judgment of the devil upon the righteous or unrighteous. Did you hear that? It's those pronounced by either children of God or children of the devil to bring the evil judgment of the devil upon anybody. Will he be righteous, unrighteous, it doesn't matter. The devil doesn't care. He hates the unrighteous just as much as he hates the righteous. Well, Brother Frank, where in the Word of God do we find just curses? I never heard of such a thing. I'm glad you asked that. Turn to Genesis 9. And for those of you who don't have that scripture, you got another one, don't worry. Just hold it. We'll get there. Genesis 9. Beginning in verse 24. Now, let's start at verse 22 this way, for those of you not familiar with the story, you can get a good background. Noah has just landed. Noah didn't land, I'm sorry. The ark landed. Noah in the ark landed. I don't want to make it sound like a UFO story, because they're demonic. Praise God. For those of you here in December, you should know that by heart. We really went into UFOs last time. It's too bad I can't go into this time, but my time is limited. Okay. And Ham, it's got nothing to do with pork. And Ham, the father of Canaan. That's important. You're to underline that. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father. Now, what happened here? What's the nakedness of Noah got to do with it all? The ark landing on Mount Ararat, Noah and his family come out of the ark. Noah builds a vineyard, and through the vineyard gets drunk and disrobes himself. Ham walks in, and now we pick up, sees the nakedness of his father, and told his brethren without. That was his mistake. He should have covered the nakedness of his father. And by the way, for a lot of you children who think you're going to go home to daddy and tell him what a sinner he is, it's your job to cover his nakedness, not to expose it. Hello. That's the message here, by the way. I'm going to go back home to daddy and show him I'm saved and what a sinner he is. You're a hypocrite. It's not your job to tell your father, and I'm not talking about your heavenly father, don't spiritualize it. I'm talking about your earthly father. You will win that man in authority, or that person in authority, by your meek and quiet spirit, just as it says in 1 Peter, the woman wins her husband by her meek and quiet spirit, not through her big mouth. Hello. And as a child, I don't care how old you are, you may be 60 and have a father that's 80, you still don't uncover his nakedness. All right, that's a mini sermon. There's no extra charge for that. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon both their shoulders and went backward. Thus, they went this way. See, they didn't see the nakedness of their father. They covered it up. And Noah awoke from his sleep at verse 24 and from his wine, and he knew what his youngest son had done to him. And notice what he says in verse 25, getting back to the subject of curses. And he said, cursed be Canaan. And what was Canaan? Canaan was in the loins of Ham. We saw that in verse 22. And Ham, the father of Canaan. And he said, cursed be Canaan. What's the curse? Now, what consists of the curse? A servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren. That's the curse. And he said, blessed be. Wow. How about that? Blessings and curses, even back in Genesis 9. And a lot of us got to go to Deuteronomy 28 to study blessing and cursing. Wave at me. Somebody out there? Hello. Good. Okay. Don't let me get my binoculars to see if you went home. Come on. He said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. God shall enlarge Japheth, and he shall dwell in the tent of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. Now, question. When Israel was finally brought out of Egypt, what land did they go and possess? The land of? And weren't the Canaanites subject to them and were servants? Sure. The ones that didn't destroy and kill. Right? Well, we have a curse here produced about 950 years before it ever took place. 950 years. Just store that in your computer bank. We'll go to the next one. Joshua. Yeah, let's go to Joshua. Joshua 6. Let's go to that one. Joshua chapter 6. Verses 26 and 27, all right? And Joshua adjured them. Now, this is after the defeat of Jericho, after the angels pushed down the walls. By the way, they didn't knock them over. Understand that? The angels did not knock the walls of Jericho over, because they were so thick that if the angels would have pushed them over, just by them being thick and falling over, it would have made another wall. And the Israelites could have never got in. If you study the accurate word in the Strong's Concordance, it means as someone depresses something into the ground. They actually, the angels went swoosh, and the walls were depressed so that the Israelites, hey, look at that. Look, Mom, no wall. Glory. And they just walked right in to the city of Jericho. Okay, anyway. And Joshua adjured them at the time, saying, cursed be the man, notice the word, we're talking about curses. Cursed be the man before the Lord that riseth up and buildeth the city Jericho. He shall lay the foundation thereof in his firstborn. That means in the death of his firstborn. And in his youngest son shall he set the gates up. In other words, his firstborn or his oldest shall die when the man, whoever it may be, shall lay the foundation of Jericho. And when he sets up the gates, his youngest son shall die. So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame was noised throughout all the country. Now, let's get the fulfillment of that. And you, in order to get the fulfillment of that scripture, you need to bounce into the future to 1 Kings. In his days did Hio, the Bethelite, build Jericho. Now, what was the curse against? The man who built Jericho, or who would rebuild Jericho, is more correct. He laid the foundation thereof in Abiram, his firstborn. How about that? And set up the gates thereof in the youngest son, Segub, according to the word of the Lord which he spoke by Joshua, the son of Nun. Now 550 years have elapsed. 550 years, and the curse came to pass. I'm trying to impress you with the number of hundreds of years that take place in someone's history, and the curse is still there. I wonder how many hundreds of years we have to go back to break curses in your history. Okay, we're under, and these, by the way, are not evil curses. They seem pretty bad. People are dying. But they're just because it meets the definition, and they're carrying out the just judgment of Almighty God. Turn to 2 Kings. Since we're in Kings, go to 2 Kings. In 2 Kings 2:23. And he went up from thence unto Bethel, he being Elisha. Elisha having seen the translation of Elijah, the mantle now falling on Elisha. And he went up from thence to Bethel. And as he was going up by the way, there came forth little children. And this does not mean little children like 3 or 4 year olds. They were in their teenage years, from what I can read from the actual word. I have a Dakes Bible, and the finest Dakes says the Hebrew word is Nayar, and it means a child from the age of infancy to adolescence. Okay? So it could be anywhere in it. It just implies youth. Little children out of the city, and mocked him, and said unto him, go up, thou bald head, bald head. Go up, thou bald head. Now, what do they mean by that? Well, if you're such a man of God, Elisha, come on. Let's see you hit the wind like Elijah. That's what they're saying. Oh, come on. Where's your anointing? Where's your mantle? Why don't you go up in a whirlwind to heaven like Elijah, bald head? That's what they're saying. And he turned back and looked on them and cursed them in the name of the Lord. See, I know a lot of people who are blessing in the name of the Lord, but it's perfectly scriptural that at a given time, you can curse people in the name of the Lord. And I will show you how I have done it and be perfectly scriptural, and not an ounce of condemnation has come to me. And I'll show you why you have to do it. Hang on, people. This is not heresy. This is the word of God. It sounds strange because you never heard it before, but you just stay in there and hang on. Don't let the devil tell you something's coming forth that's not true. Curse them in the name of the Lord. What was the result, Brother Frank? And there came forth two she-bears out of the wood and tare 42 children of them. That was the judgment, just judgment of God. Okay? Let's go back to Judges. The story is the story of Abimelech. 9, beginning in verse 7. Abimelech slays all of Gideon's family, especially the boys, for the purpose of exalting himself. Well, we know the end of the story already, don't we? Hello? Those who exalt themselves shall be humbled. We know the story already, the end of it. Now, there's only one who escapes, and that's Jotham. And beginning at verse 7, when they told it to Jotham, the telling of the event, the slaying of all the males, he went up and stood on the top of Mount Gerizim and lifted up his voice and cried and said unto them, Hearken unto me, ye men of Shechem, that God may hearken unto you. And he gives a parable of the tree, the olive tree. And I'm not sure if we should take time to read it. But what it does, it puts a curse onto Abimelech. Now what I want you to do, and you can read, I suggest you, it's too much, and I don't want to go into the passage itself, but I want you to read verses 7 through 21 at a given time. And before we quote the whole thing, I'd like to just mention the very last 5 verses that we can tie in and you can see the actual curse pronounced. But when you do have time, read the whole thing. It's very edifying. Verse 17. And here's the imagery or the what the parable that Jotham said. Verse 17. For my father fought for you and adventured his life for you and delivered you out of the hand of Midian. And you know who his father was. His father was Gideon. And we all should be familiar with that story. And you have risen up against my father's house this day and have slain his sons 70 70 people upon one stone, and have made Abimelech, the son of his maidservant, king over the men of Shechem, because he is your brother. If ye then have dealt truly and sincerely with Jerubbabel, another name for Gideon, and with his house this day, then you rejoice, ye, in Abimelech, and let him also rejoice in you. But if not, let fire come out from Abimelech and devour the men of Shechem and the house of Milo. And let fire come out of the men of Shechem and from the house of Milo and devour Abimelech. Okay, let's move down to verse 57. And let's read this. And all the evil of the men of Shechem did God render upon their heads, and upon them came the curse of Jotham, the son of Jerubbabel. How about that? The curse came to pass, and it was a just curse. Now, something that the Lord showed me that was very fundamental, and I did not understand in this story. Go back to verse 7 for a moment. And when they told it to Jotham, he went up and stood on the top of Mount Gerizim, and lifted up his voice and cried, and said, and he pronounced the curse. What is Mount Gerizim, and what does that have to do with this story? Well, how many of you remember that when the Israelites finally come out of Egypt, they had to pass through a valley? And the valley was called Shechem. After the city was made, it was called Shechem. If you look on your maps, if you have Old Testament maps, I encourage you to get a good one, you'll see Shechem is in the middle, in the valley, and then on one side is Mount Ebal, the Mount of Cursing. And then on the other side is Mount Gerizim, the Mount of Blessing. Right? Am I speaking strange? Do people generally remember something like that? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, all right. Now, you know what the purpose of those two mountains were? You want to know what the real purpose was? So what prosperity teachers have told you in Deuteronomy 28 is not only true for the blessing part, you see. Amen. Some of the representatives from the tribe went up to Mount Gerizim, and as the Israelites walked through, they actually read to them, if you do this and this, if you do this and this, if you'll turn to the living God, if you'll hearken to all those things, then all the blessings shall come unto you. And you know what their response was? Amen. But on the same side, we go across to Mount Ebal. And as the Israelites went through, the other representatives from the other tribes of Israel read all the curses if they did not obey the Lord God. Cursed will you be in the field. Cursed will you be in your cattle. Cursed will you be in store with the botch, the itch. It starts making me itch even when I think about it, you know? And the people said, amen. All right. What is that going to do with this story? Well, where did Jotham run? To the Mount of Blessing or to the Mount of Cursing? Blessing. Wait a minute. Hey, Jotham, what are you doing? You ran to the wrong mountain. Right. We just said Mount Gerizim was the Mount of Blessing. And Mount Ebal was the Mount of Cursing. What is Jotham doing on the Mount of Blessing? And you know what the Lord showed me? I said, Lord, I says, he went to the wrong mountain. And the Lord said, no, he didn't. To explain that. And here's what I believe I received of the Lord. Jotham wanted to curse Abimelech and leave no open door for him to escape. So you know what he did? He didn't go on the cursing side to curse Abimelech, that Abimelech could appeal, if you will, to the Mount of Blessing. Jotham went to the Blessing Mountain, and when he cursed them, Abimelech was caught between Jotham's curse and then could only turn and see the curse of Mount Ebal. Jotham knew what he was doing. Amen. But you know something? There's a lot of Christians. They walk their life, and all they know is, woe is me, curse here and curse here. Well, praise God, it's time to break some curses. Amen. Well, Brother Frank, all I've ever heard so far, and all the examples you ever give, is in the Old Testament. Right. So let's go to the New Testament and find one. Acts 13. The story about St. Paul, beginning in verse 6. And this story I love so much, I'm going to read all of it. Acts 13, 6 through 12. And when they had gone through the Isle of Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus. He's also called Elymas in just a minute. Which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man, who called for Barnabas and Saul, and desired to hear the word of God. But Elymas, the sorcerer, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. All right, you get the picture? Paul and his apostles believe on the Lord Jesus. And here's this false prophet trying to turn this man away and therefore cause his soul to be damned. That's pretty serious stuff, by the way. Now, what do you do when you find someone who's trying to damn someone's soul? Well, watch what Paul did. Then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, and you better be filled with the Holy Ghost before you attempt this, set his eyes on him and said, O full of all subtlety and mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately, not 6 months later, there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. The result? Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed. Hallelujah. Being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. Paul, who was subject to blindness on the road of Damascus, used it for the purpose of the Lord to inflict it upon someone else. You might say someone else had to become blind that someone else could see. Amen. Okay, Brother Frank, you got me curious. What about curses? What about breaking them and then calling down the just judgment of God? What about it all? Well, friends, I told you at the very beginning that when I address you, I will not preach something I have not walked into. And I say that again, emphasizing it, because this is new to most of you. And you need to hear it, and you need to hear what I have walked through. Maybe it'll benefit what you're walking through or will walk through. We went to Spartanburg, South Carolina, 1979, on what Rosalie and I thought was a vacation. Even preachers can take a vacation now and then, praise God. And we just had finished delivering, or rather the Lord has just finished us in using us for deliverance, on the woman whose case history we put on the board 2 days ago, the one who had the epilepsy, whose voices of the demons you heard on a tape a couple of days ago. And little did we know, but God gave us that wisdom, so when we visited our friends, his wife, who had the very same problems, we could deliver just like that because the wisdom of God was there. You follow me? Well, during the deliverance, which she needed, we couldn't get to it. The husband wanted to tell me about an incident, and this is what I'm going to bring about as far as curses. He was having problems with his neighbor. And you know how kids do? They get in a fight with your neighbor's kids, and then they yell and scream, and you yell and scream. Before you know it, there's a television program, The Family Feud, you know. Except it's block long now, and everybody knows everybody else's business. It's one of those things. So he goes over there, knocks on the door one day. And then the door opens, and he sees the woman, and he's just about to walk in and enter, and she slams it on him. Knocks again. And all of a sudden, the door opens again, and the first thing he sees is a double-gauge shotgun. And my friend, who's about 5'11", about 275 pounds, said there is something terribly wrong here. The understatement of the century, you know. And he left very afraid. And from that moment on, every time he mowed the lawn and looked at the high window that was in the house, he'd always feel like something creepy around him. And he'd just whistle, sing praises to the Lord, and seemingly got better. Then he found out, I don't know how, that the mother-in-law living with these people was of a religion where she would light candles and pray. Well, he didn't know too much about that either. Didn't bother him. Then something else happened. One night, everyone's asleep. Children are in their room. Mom and daddy in their own. When suddenly, his daughter, about the age of my daughter, starts screaming, "Daddy, Daddy, come here quickly, Daddy. Daddy, come here quickly, I'm afraid." Well, he runs, gets his robe, he runs in there. He says, "Daddy, Daddy, there's a face in my window. Daddy, there's a face in my window." He goes over to the window. "There's no face here, honey. You must have been having a nightmare." "No, Daddy, I have no nightmares. Daddy, there's a face in the window." "No, honey, there's no face in the window." "Daddy, I saw it. Please don't go. There's a face in the window." He goes back to the window. "There's no face here." "Oh, Daddy, don't leave me. Look, if you see the face, you call me. I'll come right back, okay?" "Oh, Daddy, I'm afraid." "Don't be afraid. I'll be right here." "Okay, Daddy." Brave girl. Goes back to sleep. Face in the window. Now, was his kid imagining? You know, a kid who imagine things, you know. And a face in the window. What makes it even... Now, you may say, well, maybe the kids in the neighborhood, you know, go to the window, make a funny face, or what do they do? Well, it's kind of difficult. Their bedroom was on the second floor. Very tall children in the neighborhood, you know. Well, as we started talking about this, we discerned that there was an evil curse pronounced upon this family from all the hatred, lighting of candles, and prayer. What was our definition? You forgotten? To pray. Well, we have good connotations of prayer. But the devil's people pray too. To pray, to invoke or call upon a divine or supernatural power to send injury, harm, or evil upon another. Right? That's a curse. And this time, it doesn't come under the category of a just curse because it's not a child of God producing it. Okay? Not the just judgment of God. Now, we know misguided children of God can do it also. So what I felt led to do was say, do you have any objects they've given you? Yes, let's break them. And then we came against a witchcraft curse, and my friend, who's a big strapping individual, whimpered just like a baby when it left him. Amen. Well, that was a revelation. You know, this is my own friend. I used to work with him at my company. We're good buddy buddies. One in the spirit, we get along terrific. I know his stand with God. I know his determination. He's a lot more spiritual than most of you. Don't think you're super spiritual. It can't happen to you. Well, I think I alluded to this the other night. We counseled a lieutenant colonel, another victorious Christian, really walking the Lord, giving his testimonies to several full gospel businessmen's associations, has the victory, knew the power of Christ in his life, spoke in tongues, the whole bit. Then the wife comes to us. You know how wives do. Boy, he's getting cranky, irritable, real jumpy, and he's never been this way, and I feel that the Lord spoke to me, he needs deliverance. All right, bring him in. If there's nothing there, it won't go. If there is, it will. You know, I got nothing to lose. So we sat him down, and we counseled with him. This sin, that sin, not sin. And I went through it the other day. He really wasn't into anything. Until we found that a friend of his mother's had a picture, and when she knelt down to pray, being a spiritualistic medium, she would pray and invoke a curse upon him. And using the picture as a medium would, when she prays. And he had a curse, and we broke it. In fact, after we broke that, he had everything in the headroom. Everything would just manifest, his head would just flop from side to side. We cast out about 50 evil spirits after we broke the curse. 50 out of a seemingly victorious Christian. Want to know where your head pressure comes from, or your worry, or your guilt, or self-condemnation? Now, those may be there, but somebody may be putting curses on you. You know, somebody got a headache. Cast out migraine headache. Well, it may not be migraine headache. Nervous tension. It may not be nervous tension. My toe hurts. It could be a curse. Like the man said when he was here, there is no formulas and there's no hard and fast rule. Because Sister Yehudi got delivered because she had nervous tension and you got the pain in the back of your neck, it may not be nervous tension. It could be a curse. Okay. Well, that was kind of strange. Then something was even stranger. We just really started to sink our teeth into what curses really was. And one day we went to church. Rather, the church went to the building. And there was a woman that we never saw before, a Latin woman. See, where we are in Tampa, there's a lot of Cubans and a lot of Latins. And this Latin woman came up, very attractive individual, but she had a noticeable scar under her cheek, which I asked the lady how she got it, and it was there was a reason for me asking, but my pastor, who had the gift of discernment, discerning of spirits, said there's somebody here who has a spirit of oppression or something of that nature that's giving you a headache. And the woman raised her hand. But when she came forward and the pastor laid hands upon her, he looked at me and said, I walked over. What's the problem? His brother says, I witnessed that there's, it's not just oppression. She's got a headache, but it's not just an oppressive spirit. I believe there's something in witchcraft here. You and your wife, take her in the back room and counsel her. Okay. So what do? We talked to her. Did you ever get into witchcraft? Did you ever play with the Ouija board? Did you ever do this? Did you ever do that? She said, yes, I did, but I did experience some deliverance once before. Well, that certainly made the counseling and getting the root thing a little bit more of a problem. And then I said, wait a minute. God refreshed my memory and says, remember curses? Yes, yes, okay, Lord, thank you. I said, let me ask you a question. And I asked this of a lot of people who come to counsel. I said, is there anybody you know who wants harm come to you? Or evil? And at first she went, yeah, there certainly is. As a matter of fact, I know just who it is. You see, I was born and raised in Cuba, Brother Frank, before Castro took over. And as such, we had good relations with the United States, that the Navy base used to be right there. And as a result, I started going out with one of the Navy men, and we eventually got married. But during the course of our courting, he told me that he would have to break up with his former fiancée. And he wrote her a letter. And a letter returned from her, and it said, if you leave me and you marry that girl, I'll see to it that your marriage will end and it'll never be happy. She says, and Brother Frank, I know from what he told me about his former girlfriend, that's because of the villa in Spain of where she was living. She was practicing voodoo, witchcraft, and sorcery. But that sounds like it. I said, now I knew enough at this time. I said, what is the woman's name? And she says, her name is Francesca Camacho. I said, then I witness very strongly that we should break that curse and call it the curse from Francesca Camacho. And you know what I found out? That where a proper name exists in a Christian and it's a demon, it's either one of these things. It's one, a curse from that person, idolatry from that person, or demonic soul tie or subjection to that person. If the name of the individual is there, you'll have success if you remember those four. Either it's either a curse, It's either a spirit of idolatry of that person. For instance, we cast out a spirit of Elvis Presley. Not because it was a curse from Elvis Presley, but because there was idolatry to it. You see? And they're either a demonic soul tie, a demonic subjection. Remember that as you minister. And as we cast out, we says, evil curse from Francesca Camacho, come out in the name of Jesus, and pop, out it came. Then evil curse, come out, pop, out it came. Then voodoo, witchcraft, oppression, sorcery, and then nervous tension. See, she had a lot of nervous tension problems, but all the occult were blocking nervous tension from coming out. What a lesson we learned. Well, things get stranger. You know, God leads you step by step by your faith walk. Because, you know, let's face it, the Bible talks about these things, but the Bible itself is not a deliverance manual. Amen? Okay. That's where your revelation has to take place. That's where you have enough relationship with the Lord God Almighty that if he takes you to revelation, you don't start rebuking demons because you know it's your Father giving it to you. Amen. Quiet out there. Well, one day the pastor is preaching. Well, that's nothing unusual. He usually does, you know. Praise God. And he's preaching, and no, I'm sorry. He asked me to preach this day, and he was on the sidelines. And then I asked if anybody needed prayer, and the pastor came to me. That's what happened. And he says, pray for me. I have a fungus on my fingernail. All right, so I started, me now, I am moving curses. Hey, you start breaking curses, right? And there was one there. And he started acting funny. I says, brother, I says, you're reacting like it's a demon. He says, I know. Get it. All right, this guy's a pastor, though. Pastors get demons, pastors. Amen. So we broke it, and then I started calling other things, and he started reacting and says, this looks like it's going to be a big job. We'll get you later. Okay, he knew what I meant. And unbeknownst to me, my wife was sitting next to an individual who was getting word of knowledge. And as I'm breaking the curse, the woman's poking Rosemary and saying, hey, do you hear the drums? What drums? Do you hear those beats? Boom, 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 boom. No, I hear no boom, booms. You know, nothing there, you know. It's nothing there. And the music. You hear the music? No, no music, no boom, booms, no drums. Nothing, nothing. And then Rosalie says, wait a minute. You're getting word of knowledge about what he's got. And Rosalie says, I know what that is. That's incantation. This guy is a pastor. So we got him in his little room. And we started performing deliverance, and we broke curses, and we broke this. And then Rosalie walked in and said, get incantation. Thank you. Incantation, come out in Jesus' name. Out it came. I said, where did you pick up incantation? Voodoo. Sorcery. Evil curse. Occult. You're not in it. I know you're alive, but you're not in it. Well, wait a minute. Now, remember what we're talking about today. We're talking about curses that exist from pronouncing. Right? And right now, we've skipped the just curses, and we're on to evil. Remember, that's where we are now. He said, wait a minute. You know I was pastor of the church in such and such. Yeah? Yeah, he says, and you know something? There was a woman who came from Jamaica who got me aside one day and wanted me to finance having all of her family come to the United States. And I couldn't do it. She had a lot of family. I says, lady, I just can't do it. I don't have that kind of money. He says, but we'll pray about it and see what the Lord wants, that type of thing. She got very vindictive. And one day, he goes out to the church before he normally goes there, and I'll just show you what the lady's doing. She's got a bucket of water, and she has a laver. And she's going around the church, sprinkling with water, mumbling something. And when the pastor said, what are you doing? She said, I'm blessing the church. Hello out there. Don't go home on me yet. I'm blessing the church. No, it's just the opposite, I'm afraid. We had another woman come to us. In fact, the woman who gave the word of knowledge about the incantation to Rosalie. And this woman could not get rid of certain things. And because her life involved a divorce between her and her husband, there was a lot of bitterness and vindictiveness on the part of her husband towards her. And he would call her on the telephone and say things to her and threaten her and intimidate her. Now, where threatening and intimidation are, that should flash a neon sign in your mind and say, possibility of curses there. Okay? And we discerned that right away. We broke curses. She started getting free. And then she says, well, wait a minute now. You know something? I always had the fear of being overweight, Brother Frank. The fear of being fat. You know, and my brother. Well, you know, he used to play softball and this, and I always wanted to get in the game. You know how sisters do. I said, yeah, I know that. And he always used to taunt me. And in fact, his tauntings would be it's something like, I'd be fat and ugly when I get old. In fact, he took the time to put it to music. And he would taunt me, would sing a song, and I just sensed something evil when he said it. I said, I think you brought a curse. Well, get it out. All right. Overweight curse from the brother, come out in Jesus' name. Out it came. Incredible, but true. All right, Brother Frank. I understand that, but wait a minute. All the evil curses that you have given so far are just from unjust people. You said before that curses also could be produced by misguided children of God. I said that. But all the examples I've given so far are only evil people casting curses upon either righteous or unrighteous. And now comes the shocking part. Curses pronounced by Christians. Hold on, people. A 19-year-old girl came to us, filled with every demon in the book. Everything. An alcoholic from the age of 8. Suicide, fantasy, escape, rejection from her parents, perfection. You name it, she had it. Big eye, small eye, and everything in between. Amen. Did you know something? We couldn't cast anything out. We could not cast anything out of the girl. Lack of faith? No. Lack of her faith? No. What was it? The block. A curse. And if you cannot deliver someone, when the Bible says you can, look for the block. There is always a block. And I'll tell you something. As you move into the spiritual realm, you'll be more discerning of what the block is. In this case, it was a curse. But in every curse, in every case, it doesn't have to be a curse. There is no formulas. I said, sister, and in fact, Rosalie, I think it was when Rosalie and I just first started getting on curses that this happened. We were so new in deliverance that we didn't know what to do. We knew the demons were there. We couldn't cast them out. So we sit and pray. That's scriptural. So we sat. And Rosalie got the word of knowledge. She said, Frank, I heard from the God, break that curse. That's why I'm entitled these two messages, Break Those Curses. God said, break that curse. Break that curse. What does that mean? She says, I don't know. Ask her. So we asked the girl. I said, sister, I says, God just gave Rosalie a word saying, break that curse. Does that ring a bell? I didn't know the right way to phrase it because I was so new at it. But God honors that. She says, gee, it's funny you mentioned that. Oh, I knew I was going to get an answer as soon as she said that. Gee, it's funny you said that. Because, you know, I was going to such and such a church. Oh, yeah, I remember that. That way out church. Yeah, crazy doctrine. A lot of flesh. Yeah, I remember that. And you know what happened when I left that church and that pastor? I said, no, what happened? I remember as I walked out the door after I told him I was leaving, he walked out after me and said, you leave this church and I'll make sure you never prosper with God. The pastor said it. I hate to say that, but the pastor said it and produced the curse which blocked all these demons from going. And when we cast out that curse, we had to name the pastor in order for the curse to be broken. Pastors who should be blessing their congregation are now cursing them and don't even know, or worse yet, they may know they're doing it. Later on, we found that a man died from that congregation. To preach the funeral, he said, that just goes to show you what happens when you leave my covering. Have you ever been told that if you leave your church and leave the covering it affords, you lose your salvation? I'm being honest, people. I'm sorry, but that was the truth. And the only way I know those words were spoken is because the pastor I was then submitted to went to the funeral, and he says, Brother Frank, I couldn't believe how he preached the funeral. He said those words. And he implied that if anybody left, that might be a condition that we find them. Oh, God, help us. And there was another young couple that came from that church that sought deliverance from Rosalie and I. They couldn't get a job. Brother Frank, I've had 6 jobs in the last 8 months. That's incredible. I mean, even for someone who's, as the country and western song says, born to lose, even that's pretty bad. I said, it sounds like you have a curse. I said, wait a minute, what church did you go to? Joe Yuss's church. Oh, no. I said, it wouldn't be. And when you left, he said words to the effect, you'll never prosper, or you'll get out of this covering and something will happen to you. He said, yeah, in fact, he said, if you leave here, you won't prosper. Good, let's break a curse. It was there. You know, this was so, believe me, people, I see the starry-eyed looks in your faces out there, and I can't help empathizing with you, because I was once where you sit. And if I was sitting there, hearing this message from some preacher, I'd be praying in tongues like a lot of you are probably doing. And I told God, hey, Jesus, I need a confirmation. And I'll tell you something, I'm a conservative minister. Now, what do I mean by that? I don't run with every new revelation that comes my way before I get a confirmation from another man of God or woman of God, like my wife. Well, lo and behold, God is still in the prayer answering business. And one day, I go to the church that I'm submitted to, and we just happen, you know, one of those happening things? A preacher who started a charismatic work in, North Carolina. And he was once a fundy. I won't mention the denomination, all right? But you get the idea. A fundy. And I'm not going to preach his whole sermon, but one thing he said was a confirmation to my revelation on curses. And as he was speaking, he said what happened to him. He said, folks, he says, I believe in tithing. Well, I believe in tithing too. He said, but something was terribly wrong in my life. I was not prospering. And the Bible says that if I do tithe, he was quoting from Malachi, if I do tithe, that God would open the windows of heaven up and pour out blessings that I can even contain. So we were all familiar with that scripture. And he says, but I was tithing, giving another tithe, and even a tithe, half a tithe on top of that. I knew the promises of God were true, and I was going to test them. Why wouldn't God prosper him? You know, he had my attention, you know. He says so. My wife and I were just determined to find out why. Why are there no prosperities in the Word? And it's balanced with everything else. Let's not get overboard. I can tell you my prosperity. And we'll go into it tomorrow. But here's what I want to bring to point. He knew how to hear from God. His wife knew how to hear from God, so they know. Say, Lord, why aren't we prospering? And the Lord spoke to them. He said, brother, you know your family situation. Not your marriage situation, but the family you came from. They're all fundies. Your uncle's a fundy preacher. Your other uncle's a fundy teacher. Your father's a deacon. Your cousin's a preacher. Your other cousin's a teacher, a deacon. He had them all in the family. He says, what they've done is they've prayed that since you're moving into tongues, since you're moving into the Holy Spirit, since you're moving out, it appears to them that you're moving into heresy. So you know what they've prayed? For you to come back and to be a fundy once again, and they put a curse on you. Wow. Wow. I couldn't believe it. I think my mouth hit the pew in front of me. I couldn't believe it. I knew this guy didn't have revelation on curses, but yet I knew he heard from the Lord. And you know what he said? Very deliberately. Very as matter-of-factness as we could be. I just held hands with my children and my wife. I says, Lord Jesus, we've heard your word. We believe your word. I break this fundy curse in Jesus' name. We're going to serve you. We're not going to go back. I'll tell you something. You march on with the Lord, and retreating is backsliding. Hello out there. Part of this charismatic stuff is stay in your church. Stay in your church. What, when God's called you forward, you're going to stay? It might be a curse. Now, if God said stay, stay. But if God's giving you marching orders, you better march. This fella had to march. And then something beautiful started happening. Someone gave him a tiller. And he loved gardening, so he's out there one day playing with his pillow. And then there's a knock on the door. And his wife answers the door because he's playing with his pillow. And she looks and says, "Oh, dear, I'd better go get my husband. Would you come in?" She runs, "Father, husband, come here." He walks in, says, "Look, and there's one of his congregation, dressed up in a suit. His wife is nicely dressed. Children are nice. And he's holding an envelope." He says, "Brother, pastor, we have all agreed on what we're about to do. We have prayed about it, and I'm in agreement with my wife. My children are in agreement with both she and me. And we'd like to give you this. Open it." Now, at that time, he began starting a work similar in a city 30 miles away. And he didn't know how he was going to be able to commute. And he tears open the envelope and pulls out a set of keys and the registration to a 1979 Ford LTD station wagon. And he says, "It's yours. Do I owe you anything? The only thing you owe me, brother, is your love. It's yours." He says, and you know something, brother? We wanted to give this to you for a long time, but only recently did we feel relieved to give it to you." Yeah. That's what happens when you stop breaking curses. People will be released. And you could go and serve God and not drive the old Volkswagen that was made in 1962, but to drive a brand new Ford LTD. Amen. This is exactly the message Rosalie and I were prepared for by God before we went to Canada last year. And as we met another pastor and his wife, Rosalie and I couldn't help looking at that woman. Now our discernment was really sharp. Now after going through all these curses, boy, I tell you, you start seeing people, you start picking up things. It doesn't happen all the time, but it happens more frequent than when it did. And as we laid our eyes on her, boy, she looks awful. She's only about 29 or 31, somewhere in there. Maybe 33 years old at most. Good-looking woman. Tall, sort of big frame, but her eyes look like this, you know. Goodness gracious, dark under her eyes, just like there was something terrible on her head or weight or shoulders. You just got that impression, you know. And all of us, Rosalie, me, and the other pastor's wife, said, "What do you discern of that?" Man, she oppressed. "All right, let's cool it. Let's not come out with any big revelations. Let's see if the Lord..." Well, it just so happened that God used Rosalie and I on a television program where I was able to share my testimony and a little bit about deliverance. And at that moment, little did I know, but the Lord spoke to that woman that we discerned back in Winnipeg. And as she watched the TV program that we were on, God says, "That's the man I sent to set you free." Now listen to this. I didn't volunteer anything. I didn't push deliverance on her. And you better not push deliverance on anybody either. You wait till the Lord says, "Go." Otherwise, you follow directions as that old game. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Go directly to jail. Amen. And I sat at the dinner table, and she came over with the mashed potatoes, you know. And these were the words that came out of her mouth. "Heavy, heavy, over my head. Heavy, heavy, over my head." Beg your pardon, ma'am? What do you think? I said, you know, so I say, I know we're not the best company, but you just have to make do. It really didn't do too much to my ego. My wife says I got foolishness. You can get me later. Catch that out. I said, "Heavy, heavy over your who? Head?" She says, I don't even know why I said something so foolish. I don't even know why I said that. But you know, Brother Frank, ever since I've been a little girl, ever since I was knee-high to a grasshopper, I remember my mother used to constantly say, "Heavy, heavy over your head." And I'll tell you, this woman looked like there was something heavy, heavy over her head. And she said, "Brother Frank, could that be a curse?" And I nearly spilled my mashed potatoes. I couldn't believe it. Without any invitation on my own, without any revelation of telling her what the Lord showed me, God showed her. And she got free from a curse. In fact, when we laid hands on her, we were calling it childhood curse or evil curse or something. And as she just began to manifest, we went, "Heavy, heavy, come out." And went, "Ah!" And I'll tell you, this woman was big, was tall, much taller than Rosalie, about as tall as I am, and almost the same weight. It just threw her to the ground. And her husband, who was a fundy and thought he knew about deliverance, learned a little bit more. He said, "Brother, if I didn't see it happen to my own wife, I would never let you preach in my church." So we cast out a few others, and the thing I want to impress upon you is that the first heavy curse was produced by a non-Christian, because her mother was a Christian. And the second curse we produced is when they left a fellowship and someone prayed that they wouldn't succeed. "You'll never succeed in the Lord. You won't make it." They didn't. And when we broke those curses, we broke all the chains of events, their transmission going, their engine blowing up, bills to pay, where to get the money, bank financing, not to be able to come through, and all this other stuff was the curse. Hello? "Well, Brother Frank, now I'm paranoid. Does everybody pick up curses?" No. So don't get paranoid. Everybody doesn't pick them up. But why not? All the examples you told me did. That's right. And I'm not going to leave you here hanging without telling you how not to pick up curses. Very remiss of my teaching if I did that. Well, how do people not pick up curses? Well, for several reasons. In the curse of Balaam, everybody should know that old story. Balak hires Balaam, come and curse Israel. Now, here's a point. Let's stop here just for a moment. If there's nothing to what I'm saying about evil pronunciations, now listen, if there's nothing to what I'm saying, why do we find so early in the Bible of someone paying all this dough to hire somebody to perform a curse if there's no value to it? I mean, come on, let's be logical. If there's nothing to it, why does Balak first send some money and some riches, and then when he can't persuade Balaam, he goes with more princes, higher in authority, more nobles, with more cash and more gold? If there's nothing to it. Amen. We should learn our curse story right there. It's as plain as anything else. But here's the thing. God knew how important it was for Israel not to be cursed. That's why he changed the words in Balaam's tongue. And now that even tells me there's more emphasis on curses than should be placed. The evil guy, Balak, knew the value, and so did God. And God said, "I better stop it before that curse could be." So the first thing is stop the curse before it comes to be. Well, God, most of the time, does that by his sovereignty. But people, when we start moving in word of knowledge, word of wisdom, and discerning of spirits, I believe we can move there also. So God stopped it, and praise God, the curse never came to be. Well, what happens now, Brother Frank, of curses are they offloading around, such as the 950 years example and the 550 year example. What about that? Well, if you know and are conscious that people have prayed against you, rebuke it and don't receive it. And this first would be a defensive measure, and then an offensive measure. We'll get into it a little bit more in the later. Just hold on. First, you don't receive it. Say, "Wait a minute, I don't receive that." You know, some people, "Oh, Satan's at my doorstep. He's knocking. He's knocking at my door. You hear him? Yeah, don't answer him." You know, everybody's got to open the door. See, who's there? It's me. Oh, more curses. You know, don't answer the door. "Satan's always on my doorstep. Pick him off. If he's always on your doorstep, I would think he's more of a friend than an enemy." Hello? Yes. Don't receive it. Rebuke it. Stand against it. And then pronounce a curse of your own. What? Me pronounce a curse? I couldn't do it. Elijah did. Joshua did. And God saw it as a just curse. Well, aren't we the just? Now let's not be misguided people, children of God, and pronounce evil curses. Let's be in the spirit and produce just curses. Because you see, an evil person can only produce an evil curse, but a just person can either produce a just or an evil one. And we need to be in the spirit, not in the flesh. Yeah. Well, Brother Frank, is that scriptural to return the curse? Psalms 109:17 says, "As he that loveth cursing, let it come unto him." Amen. In fact, I said something yesterday that I'd like to catch up and pick up today about David and Goliath. And I want you to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17. I made a bold statement the other day, but I'm not going to pass it by without explaining it. 1 Samuel chapter 17. Now, I read about the story of David and Goliath when we discussed the Goliaths in your life, and I'm not going to go over it, but I do, for the purpose of talking about curses, I do have to amplify these verses. Beginning in verse 43. Now, we all know the story. Goliath is infuriated that this little kid, ruddy complexion, curly hair, small than he is, to meet him, great Goliath. And what does he do? Verse 43. And the Philistine said unto David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? Now, what does the next part of that verse says? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. Isn't it interesting that before Goliath hurled his javelin that he held in his hand with his own flesh, he was performing supernatural warfare? Did you ever see that before in the Word? How many of you have never seen that in the Word before? Raise your hand. Praise God. Before Goliath even attempted, he started throwing curses. Well, the discussion now is how not to receive it. David won the battle, so I guess he didn't receive it. What was his plan for victory? Let's go down to verse 45. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword, and with a spear, and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of the host, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied, and out of David. In other words, David resisted him. Do you see the resisting? Okay, you got a big fat shield in front of you, fatso. But I'll tell you something, my spiritual shield is bigger than your physical shield. My spiritual shield comes in the name Lord God of hosts, and I hold it up before you, and I kick your curses back to you. I don't receive them. Now, David just didn't stand defensive weaponry. No, he didn't. Read the very next verse. This will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thy head from thee. And I will give the carcass of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air, to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there's a God in Israel. Amen. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Point in fact is David pronounced the curse of his own. You come to me with a sword and spear? Got news for you, big guy. I come to you in the name of the Lord God of hosts, and I hold physical shields. In fact, you got all this armor. You got all this, the spear as big as a weaver's spear. And I come to you with a tiny little slingshot and one little stone, and I'm not worried. I'm not frustrated. I don't have guilt and self-condemnation, and I'm worried about your cursing. Now, he wasn't using profanity, like we said before. He was invoking, call upon, it says, his gods. Amen? And David both used his defensive spiritual weaponry, since he had no shield, no physical shield, that is. But he used his spiritual weaponry, his shield, and then he took his sword, and maybe when he saw one of those curses coming, he said, four! Amen. Now, I gave you two hair-raising examples of people who submitted to a church, and they brought curses. But all the people who left that church didn't buy a curse. We had a very lovely couple in our body that left the same exact out-of-balance church that this couple I told you about before. They didn't pick up any curses. I said, how come you didn't pick up any of his retribution? And I said, wait a minute. I said, did he ever tell you anything like that? Oh, he says he sure did. When I left his fellowship, he said, you're not going to prosper. This is going to happen to you. This guy. And it was the man, not the woman. Now you listen to that. Remember we talked about spiritual coverings. The man turned to him and said, I don't buy all that junk. That's all he said. He didn't say, in the name of Jesus, I come against you. I rebuke you. I don't buy all that junk. And he didn't. It's time to stand. Not to be rebellious. No, I don't want to be rebellious. But I don't want to be a gutless, spineless jellyfish who gets everything that everybody puts on him. Martyr complex? No. I stand as a man in the day of battle. Ephesians also tells, having done all, stand. Stand, tell the enemy where to come off, and he will flee with his tail tucked between his legs. You've been delivered. You know what the deliverance services is like. I'm not going to come out. And next few seconds, they're crying, please keep me in. Some enemy. Hold up the shield of faith. The Bible says, with which we are able to quench the fiery thoughts of the wicked. Amen. Quench a few. And send it back to the one who pronounced it. And that means, performing a curse of your own. Now let's go a little flashback. You remember what I told you about the curse of witchcraft produced on my friend and the kids saw the evil faces in the window? We just did not cast out a curse of witchcraft. He said, okay, Frank, you've done that, but these people still live here and they still could put more curses on me. You know, I said, you're right. Then what do? Let's hold hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, we command that ministry to dry up. Do you hear that? We should command the ministry of Satan to dry up. We curse it. I mean, when you call something into death, it's a curse, isn't it? My Bible says Jesus cursed the fig tree and it died. That's right. And when you command a ministry to dry up, it's a curse. Now, God help the man who says, command that Christian ministry to dry up. You see the difference? There's where, let's say I did that, I would be a just Christian performing an evil curse. Well, in this case, I'm a just Christian performing a just curse. I could command Satan's ministry to dry up. That's what God wants us to do, is defeat the enemy. And we should have his ministry dry up before he sends more curses. Is it scriptural? Yep. He that rolls a stone, it shall fall back onto him. And he that diggeth a pit, he'll fall therein. Proverbs 26:27. Cast it out because there's a demon attached to a curse, just as there's an angel attached to a blessing. As we started dealing about curses, just in Louisiana, where we came from, we had found that there was someone in the occult, in a generation, in a family line, that realized she was going to die one day, and put a curse on the family line that one of those grandchildren would be raised up in her stead. Isn't that horrible? Now, here, and this was the great-grandmother. Look how many generations that is. What, four? Great-grandmother? Four. So, the child's born. She's got all these problems. She's never got into sin. What's the problem? How can this happen? Curses. And we call it the curse of royal inheritance. And it responded to the name and came out. Little did I know I was going to use it in the congregation here at Lake Hamilton. And what we discerned in this woman that we delivered today was that she had the curse of royal inheritance from a gypsy grandfather who prayed that somebody in the generations of his family would eventually to come to the role he played in the family. At the same time, there was a curse of physical and mental illness. And just as we got them and cast them out successfully, the husband very astutely discerned that because we cast them out, the strong man had to try to come to the rescue. You see, these two curses, the curse of royal inheritance and the curse of physical and mental curse, you might say, were co-partners, partners in crime. And we asked them, because they were very talkative, and they said, we share the ground, we share the territory. I take this part, the other demon takes the other part. But that just didn't set with me. There had to be a ruling spirit, a ruling demon. And we found out what it was. As we started dealing with the wife, all of a sudden, a demon started saying, what are you all doing? Who do you think you are? This. All of a sudden, started speaking in a notable English accent. You think you're so smart? Well, I've been here and I'm not leaving. My God, what do we have here? Now, we are ready. Now, here's the thing that was plaguing this poor man who happens to be in the deliverance, some type of deliverance himself. That He says, you know, Frank, these demons keep coming back and we keep casting them out. And I said, I know what you got. You got gatekeeper. And he did. There was a gatekeeper spirit allowing. What does the gate do? Open and close, right? Hallelujah. So you know what he do? We cast them out. Gatekeeper will open. And then we fall under condemnation that we can't hold our deliverance when we really can. How about that? So we knew, I knew there was gatekeeper there. And gatekeeper, his very function is to know who's in there and who is not. We got a lot of information out of him today. He told us who was in there. And the first things that he identified is that there were two who were partners in crime. That is, these two right here. The curse. These are all curses now, unless I say otherwise. A curse of royal inheritance, being partners in crime and sharing the territory with a curse of physical and mental illness. They would share the territory and they were co-equal. But we found that when this, and we're talking to gatekeeper, the English accent came and we knew it wasn't gatekeeper anymore. And we said, well, who are you? And I noticed the English thing. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I think I know what we have here. And the demon looked at me. And I says, you're from England, right? And I said, you wouldn't be a medieval curse, would you? And that's what it was. Thousands of years ago. What did we just teach? A curse that could exist 950 years? A curse pronounced thousands of years ago was put upon this innocent child. A medieval curse of infirmity. And you know how it ruled? It ruled with its two subordinates. Royal inheritance, which would jack up the occult side from her gypsy grandfather. And a curse of physical and mental illness, which would split the ground between the curses in the mental area and the curses in the physical area. And here's all the curses that we broke in the mental realm. Curse of nervous breakdown. The curse of insanity. Now, these are not spirits. These are curses. The curse of intertwined minds. Now, because the brother was into deliverance, I said, what the heck is that? Well, he says, believe it or not, but you know what you have here, Brother Frank? And this is not my revelation. It's because he had it, and I had some, and he had some, that we both work together like we should in the kingdom of God to bring forth deliverance that we all need. And this is his revelation, not mine. He said, Brother Frank, you know what you got here? He says, you have a demon that's been cursed by more powerful demons. And it's been cursed in such a way that its mind is intertwined with my wife's. And you need to break the curse of intertwined minds before you actually get that demon out. And you know what that demon was telling us? Its demon, and the demon was called Beelzebub, whose function was to torment the poor woman sexually as she dreamed. And we sometimes have the incubi, succubi, which if you know what that is, it's in the occult realms, male demon spirits who try to force procreation and rape on female women. And succubi, which is the opposite, female spirits who try to naturally force their things on the men. And so what she was going through with the Beelzebub spirit was that. And Beelzebub spirit was saying, just break the curse and I will leave her. And when we broke the curse, all of a sudden she was powerful again. And the brother said to me, you know why she's resisting us now when before she told us to go? It's because now her mind is unlinked with my wife's because we broke the curse and now she wants to make it incredible but true. But we cast it out and it went. Now with intertwined minds, there were other things that the devil decided to put in there to create the curse of mental illness and to bring forth other things, and that was the curse of schizophrenia. How messed up we can be, huh? Not due to our own. And schizophrenia manifested in this way. Not only did she have herself and another, She had the A, the real. Then she had the other. Now, for schizophrenia, that's what you would normally have, the real and the other. But then she had another one called the evil. Let's say your name is Christopher, and you have schizophrenia, and they cast out real. Well, you can't cast out real, that's you. But let's say they cast out the other, that's your other split. But then there's an evil Christopher. And we cast out evil, whatever her name was. But then, because the mind likes to play tricks and she was hit with fantasy and escape, it was also baby. Goo Goo and Gaga was still there. How messed up we can be? Four instead of one. Each one phasing in and out when they like to manifest, for instance. Well, how do these things torment her, Brother Frank? Well, let's say things didn't go too right. She didn't have her way. And she knew by her own power she couldn't dominate over her husband. Well, she just calls on wicked so-and-so. Let's make up a name. Let's call her Lucy. There's the real Lucy, the other Lucy, the evil Lucy, and the baby Lucy. If real Lucy wants to serve God but yet wants to win an argument, and she realizes she can't do it, boom, summons wicked Lucy. Wicked Lucy takes things into her own hands. And wicked Lucy is a female demon. You know why? Because the Bible commands the women never to usurp the authority over the male. That's why it's got to be a female. We're learning something. Then there's the other. Well, when there's things are not going right and there's no real need for evil Lucy to come, we call on the other, and the other takes her where she wants to go. Then when the other or evil can't really manifest and she wants a means of escape and realize that drugs, alcohol, and nicotine are out of the question, she elapses into mental regression, into a baby state. That's her escape. We have just touched the surfaces, friends, on curses. Okay? Same thing as yesterday, but we're going to a new area. Are you ready to renounce those things that have you bugged? Okay? Father, in Jesus' name, I believe in deliverance. I may need some more deliverance. Not to boast in deliverance, but in you. Who's redeemed me, who shed his blood for me, and who's given himself as a ransom for many. I want to serve you. I remember that prophecy before, and I know where my heart and mind must be. And I want to go on with you. Therefore, I renounce all ungodly, satanic, demonic influence on my life, whether it be around me or in me. I renounce. Speak it out, children. What's got you bound? Speak it out. We come against the curse of perpetual open door in Jesus' name. Loose God's people and let them go. Curse of perpetual open door out in Jesus' name. Out in Jesus' name. Curse of perpetual open door out in Jesus' name. Out in the name of Jesus. Out of this couple in Jesus' name. Out of this couple in Jesus' name. Gatekeeper. Gatekeeper who makes the demons go in and out. Get out of her in Jesus' name. Gatekeeper, get out. Out. I see you. Get out. Get out. Out of Jesus' name. It's in this woman and it's in these children here. Get out of Mary in Jesus' name. Gatekeeper, out. 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 Gatekeeper, out in Jesus' name. Out in Jesus' name. They'll scream, but they'll come out. Don't worry about it. Keep your eyes on me. Gatekeeper, get out in Jesus' name. Out in the name of Jesus. Loose them. Loose this man and let him go. We come against and we break a curse of royal, demonic, and occult royal inheritance in the name of Jesus. We come against, she's got it, I need someone to pray with that woman. Out in Jesus' name. A curse of royal inheritance and out in Jesus' name. Curse of royal inheritance, out in Jesus' name. Out. Curse of demonic royal inheritance.
This is the end of this message.